she went out to seek a living of her own. She went to the city where she lived earning through sex work, and she had no regret for her because at least she was living a life, executing her own choices. Whereas her sister, she was rotting under the veil of family that used to cover the violent misogynistic norms of their tradition. Now there was a horrifying custom in the family that followed a very violent ritual where every second girl child, and this is a part of their tradition, that every second girl child is thrown against a wall. It is said that this bloodshed in the thickness of the night is offered to someone who cannot be named, and this is done for the betterment of the community. The mother of Sela, Mama Leru, she herself was a second girl child, and she has survived this horrifying ritual. And therefore, now she needed to have a true successor who could also, you know, survive this horrifying ritual. Therefore, only her daughter Sela could give her this success, this true successor. Sela had already given birth to three girl children who had been thrown against the wall and killed instantly. Hatred and bloodshed had become so common to this household that killing babies did not, you know, bring any remorse. And Mama Leru didn't even paid any attention to her daughter's physical and emotional exhaustion. She brought in new men to rape her own daughter, so obsessed she was to have a successor. When Sela was at a loss, as Mama Leru, because of her old age, went to her deathbed, this narrator comes into the scene. She becomes an empathetic listener. She helps her sister Sela to get over through this trauma. And together, what they do after Mama Leru's death, they burn down the home. And you know, the last line says that there my sister and I watched the home burn, and therefore people of the town before the people of the town could gather, my sister and I promised each other that never to speak of home again. So post independence, Africans have witnessed changes in the political and the social structures, with the world being divided into the developed industrial countries and underdeveloped primary producing countries, the latter become more and more dependent on the former. Even after political independence, the economic structures of African countries continued to be dependent on their colonizers and other superpowers. The economic and the social dependency, struggle of decolonizing the mind, the struggle of tracing the cultural roots, and the process of reclamation brought in new agonies regarding existence and identity. Now, my paper had tried to locate the different realities, subversions, and the newer problems regarding gender and race that African short story try to deal with. At this critical juncture of history, one must celebrate the solidarity among women and the establishment of a sisterhood where these remarkably strong women are no longer mute and oppressed. You know the term third world woman that the white feminists love to call us, but they're actually fighters and healers and seekers of self-liberation with the immense capabilities of executing their personal agency. They defy the oppressor not only for themselves, but they stand up and fight for their compatriots too. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Shreyashi, for this wonderful paper. Anyway, I would like to move on. And this is a request to all the participants that please try to stick to the time if possible. If you do not do that, this session will be a very long session. We do not actually, none of us actually want that. Anyway, so I would like to call Imo Okon, Ekimini, Umuka, Mary, Ukpong, once again, if you are here, please start your presentation. If you are not, then we will move on to the next presenter. Are you there? So our first presenter is not there. In that case, I would like to call Professor Shubhayu Chakraborty, Professor Shubhayu Chakraborty from Sudhir Ranjan Lahiri Mahavidyalaya. Sir, please, would you like to start the presentation?
Absolutely. Now, is the screen visible?
Not yet, sir. If you are delivering a PowerPoint presentation, it is still not visible, sir.
Okay, I'm just try. Okay, window. Okay, I'll do it. Just hold on. Yes. Actually, it's in the phone tab. No, it's not there. I'll leave it. I'll just say it.
Definitely, sir.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Okay, am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are perfectly audible, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm Shubhayu Chakraborty, Assistant Professor in the Department of English at Sudhir Ranjan Lahiri Mahavidyalaya. Today, I'm going to talk about a graphic novel named Aya, Life in a York City. Now, since the topic has already been introduced by the chair, naturally, I'm not going to go with it once again. So let me start my paper. You see, it is a fact that any discourse on dressing as a part of popular culture or its ever-changing prototype in the literature of colonized nations has never been given much attention by literary and cultural critics. It is apparently because dress styles belong to visual discourse, whereas a majority of literature or cultural texts that we come across are simply meant for reading, and the focus is more on imagination rather than seeing, to go to the romantic notion actually. Over the years, writers have restricted themselves in describing only the body parts, leaving out other essential and vital accomplishments that complement them, such as dresses and hairdos or hairstyles or coiffures. The literature and cultural texts of Africa also suffered the same lacuna. Aya, Life in New York City, which is published in 2012, is an exception because it is in the format of a graphic novel. Now, I personally don't like calling this kind of format a graphic novel. Rather, I would love to stick to comics, because graphic novels are nothing but a publishing and marketing term given to comics. See, as an offshoot of popular culture, comics are deeply rooted in the socio-cultural milieu they breathe in. In their potential of engaging both the verbal and the visual perspectives of readers, they emerge as a double-edged dynamic genre. The canvas of comics, your graphic novel, obviously, offers a matrix of encoded signs of cultural production. Representation in the graphic form becomes a tool of portraying people and situations in a more appealing way. The vivid visuals as expressions of ideas are greatly stimulating to the readers. The novel under study offers possibilities of discussion on hairstyling and dressing, because both the elements are quintessential to the citizens of Côte d'Ivoire or the Ivory Coast, a country in the south coast of West Africa. You see, this particular novel is written by Margaret Abou and illustrated by Clemé Obéry. Margaret Abou is Ivory Coast born French writer, and Clemé Obéry is obviously a French illustrator. Now, this particular novel, it gives an account of the writer's early life in Yukungon, which is a suburb in Abidjan, which is the capital of Ivory Coast, and this particular city is basically occupied by the working class populace. The timeline of the novel is late 1970s and early 1980s, during the reign of their charismatic president, Félix Hoppe Bojini. Through the eyes of the female protagonist Aya, Yukungonian society is laid bare. It tells the story of Africa far removed from the cliches, wire and famine. You see, whenever we talk about Africa, especially the Eurocentric kind of ideology, we think that Africa is a place which is dark. It's a dark continent where we are more interested with the war, the famine, and so on, and prostitution, and so on and so forth. But in this particular graphic novel, the name of Yukungon is named as York City, which is a far-fetched allusion to the New York City, which reveals the image of its socializing space, postmodern lifestyles, and obsession for popular culture. So the narrative is loaded with events that showcase the interest of York City dwellers in adapting to foreign cultures as advertised in newspapers and televisions. The hairstyles and dressing senses becomes tools of articulating personal desires, sensualities, fragmented personality that issue from the search for new identity. The images and dresses and the hairdos which are drawn from this particular text will be scrutinized as cultural signifiers in visual discourse. So three things would come into consideration when we take this text under study. Firstly, we will talk about postmodernism. We would talk about postcolonialism. And thirdly, we would talk about semiotics. But as time is short, I will just touch upon all the things. You see, this particular text opens in the year 1978. I wish I could have shown you the PowerPoint, right? With a large panel of a television set, which played the advertisement of Solibra. Solibra is a locally brewed beer. And this particular advertisement is being anchored by a very famous local comedian who, after consuming the beer, had the power to blow the buses by his bicycle. In the very next panel, we get a group of working class people together, family and friends. They actually watch the advertisement together. It is interesting that this particular advertisement is aired regularly at 9 p.m. and still all of them sit together and watch the same advertisement every night, or every evening rather. You see, from here we can see that in the Ivorian society during the late 1970s, popular culture has already intruded. Now, I wouldn't give you the definition of popular culture, rather I would give you some facets of it. See, according to me, popular culture is the entertainment that we get from the commercial media, and it reaches a large number of people who are geographically dispersed, and the popularity of the products are measured by the patterns of consumption. To put it more simply, popular culture refers to the things we buy. It is what the people make to do for themselves. So the television set in Aya's room, or the various bars and discotheques which are at the Ivory Coast, the beauty contest about which I would be talking, the songs which are played at the studio or at the disco or at the weddings, the dresses of the people, the hairstyle of the people, they all allude to the Eurocentric popular culture that has already infiltrated in Ivory Coast. So, in fact, it is the European light which is focused on the dark continent to remove the darkness from Africa, just as we have in the Fair and Lovely advertisements. Right. Now, before we move into the next portion of the text, I will give you a glimpse of the Ivorian history. You see, Ivory Coast, it was a French colony, and it gained independence in 1960. But even after gaining independence, the French supported the country with economic and military measures. Interestingly, the president was so charismatic, and he focused on the agrarian things. His focus was on the land use of the person who cultivates it. And as a process, we found a meteoric rise in the economic growth, which was termed as the Ivorian miracle. And the president was far-sighted also. He opened the door for foreign investments also. And as a result, entire Ivory Coast was growing with the economic boom. And this is when the particular novel is set. You see, in York City or Yukongon, we find that the elements of pop culture and the social rituals, they actually serve as symbols to build individual and collective identity, which is very important. You see, everybody over there preferred all forms of exotism. Now, and fashion is an important kind of such thing. Now, what is fashion? Fashion is a form of imitation and of social equalization. It unites those of a social class and segregates them from others. The elite imitates a fashion, and when the mass imitates it, and in an effort to obliterate the external distinctions, abandons it for a newer mode, a process that quickens with the increase of wealth. So naturally, fashion is ever dynamic, it is ever changing. Not only that, fashion is an important element in every culture because it provides a communal identity. But with the inflow of popular culture, the age-old traditional fashion gave way to the exotic. The aged and the young, the poor and the rich, all alike, embraced the imported fashion. You see, the social events like marriage ceremony, beauty pageants, even funerals, they provided opportunities to flaunt their newest dresses and hairstyling. When we talk about New York City, the fashion statement of New York City rested in the able hands of two people. One is Sikidi, who is the city's popular tailor, or rather a fashion designer, and Ino, the hairstylist and the owner of city's most celebrated salon. You see, I would talk about a particular portion of the text. When there is a marriage between two persons, a lot of girls surround this particular tailor, Sikidi. And one of them demands, "My Catherine Deneuve dress needs to be a shorter." So Catherine Deneuve is basically a famous French film star during the 1970s, and due to the inflow of popular culture, even her films were aired in Ivory Coast. So every woman wanted to be a Catherine Deneuve. And not only that, they wanted to put the fashion statement of Catherine Deneuve, and they want to personalize it by cutting it a bit shorter. So the tailor remarks, "What do you want, a dress or a shirt?" So naturally, it is not something which is new in Ivory Coast. It happens everywhere, even in the developing nations like India during the 1970s. Now, obviously, none of us were born over then. Now, naturally, you find people with Amitabh Bachchan hairstyles, or every girl wanted to look like a Hema Malini. So naturally, here the tailor assumes the role of a fairy godmother. So
hello, sir. Are you with us? I think there is a problem in connection. Professor Shubhayu Chakraborty, are you with us, sir? Yes.
This obsession for remaking their imperfect bodies, on one hand, challenges the Eurocentric notion that the body is a perfect creation of God, and on the other, it brings out the psychic inferiority of the native subalterns. They are in search of a makeover to create an impetus to equate them to be at par with the ideal Western white beauty, which becomes a way of asserting and satisfying their mundane existence and identity, and also paving the way for construction of fragmented identities. You see, clothes complement personality. All the characters exhibit different styles of dressing. On close analysis of the dressing culture, we find that the dwellers of the York City is divided into certain binaries. Firstly, there is a difference between the aged and the young, between the haves and the have-nots. Moreover, there is also another sharp divide between the have-olds and the have-not-old generation. So initially, when we find the old women, they wear the indigenous dresses, where the youngs wear the clothes which are dictated by the fashion magazines. The older ones, they wear pagnes or blouses with long pieces of cloth that they wrap around themselves as skirts. Now, pagnes are basically, printed cheap clothes. But when you have an upper class people over there, they use superior and costly fabric with matching headscarves. Now, obviously, the dress represents culture. When you dress well, you are of a high culture. When you don't dress well, you're obviously of the low culture. Now, obviously, every style statement is inspired by televisions, newspapers, and magazines, which are harbingers of popular culture. You see, the young generation, they prefer clothes that combine the exotic and the tropical, the global and the local, the modern and the indigenous. The dresses they wear are not imported, but the dress materials are either imported or local, which are designed and patterned according to the whims and fancies of the wearer. Right. You see, some wear slim-fit, half-sleeve blouses and skirts. The others wear sleeveless, tight-fitting things. Being to a particular character, she wears a tight-fitting skirt and blouse styled Ankara, which helps her to front the contours of her body to be admired by men. So, even when we have a particular fashion pageant in a continent like Africa, where we have a swimsuit round also, which has been featured in this particular graphic novel, even men are also not far behind. The middle class people, they love to wear coat and tie, even they sit with that in their houses, just to show that they are at the upper ladder of the society. Whereas the young ones, they prefer t-shirts and denims. Right. Now, there is another important thing, that is hairstyling. You see, hairstyling is also an innate desire of human beings to emphasize their beauty and power. Because hair is an important aspect of one's appearance. Hence, grooming, styling, and adorning are common practices in all societies. So, popular culture talks about the exotic hairdos, and this particular hairdos attract the young generation. In this particular graphic novel, different panels display Ino's beauty salon every now and then. It is a unisexual salon where both male and female characters crowd in queue for their turn. The particular dresser's handiwork transforms their hair from pedestrian to exotic. His innate ability to copy the hairstyles of known foreign cultural figures such as musicians and actors make Ino a favorite in York City. And even people, they would love to wait for hours, to get into the salon. So naturally, I conclude saying that in Aya, the post-colonial and post-modern theories point at a sense of dressing and hairstyling as cultural signifiers. The media plays significant roles in production and distribution of meaning in Upogonian post-colonial city, as European magazines, newspapers, and televisions propagate cultural superiorities of whites over blacks. York City, as a post-colonial space, becomes prone to the Eurocentric construction of knowledge that generates social binaries, which in turn instigates craving to adapt to the superior culture by putting an end to the imperfections of the post-colonial body. York City dwellers run after building a dream to achieve perfection. The African beauty is now constructed as personal subjective and fluid, because the body is conceived as a decorative surface for exhibiting during ceremonies. The emergence of a brand new stylistic consciousness from Yop City as a margin does not seek dominance over Abidjan's cultural standards as a center. It rather shows the omnipresence of fashion and therefore the possibilities of marginal spaces, shifts paradigm, and asserts their cultural freedom. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your presentation, for the wonderful presentation. Now, I would like to call the next person, Shubhangini Priyodarshi. Shubhangini Priyodarshi.
Yes, sir.
Yes. If you are there, please proceed with the presentation.
Yes, sir. Hello?
Yes, ma'am, you are perfectly audible. Continue.
Okay, sir. Hello everyone, lovely good afternoon to all. So I'm here to present my views on a very sensitive part of African literature, that is, I have entitled as Negotiating the Black Motherhood in Slavery. So before proceeding, I would like to share how I reached this topic. As once I was watching a movie. While I was going through the movie, I felt like I'm already acquainted to the scenes. And while after searching, I got to know that it is an adaptation of a famous novel. So I was really excited about knowing this a widely accepted form of literature. So I was so excited about this topic that I also started searching about it more and more. And later, I also made my dissertation on the same topic. So I've entitled it as From Pages to Screen, Study of Select Slave Narratives. So it is a topic of my dissertation. But while I was going with my dissertation, I also got to know about more of the slave narratives. So while I was going with it all, so I got to read about Beloved by Toni Morrison. And after reading the novel, I was completely mesmerized and shocked too that how beautifully Morrison has depicted the slavery, the condition of women in as slaves, the conditions of mothers as slaves. So I started researching more and more about it. And this webinar has provided me with a perfect platform for satisfying my enthusiasm. So I will now proceed with my presentation. So, is the presentation visible?
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
Okay. As I have already introduced with the title, it is Negotiating the Black Motherhood in Slavery. So, this presentation titled Negotiating the Black Motherhood in Slavery, the objective of this paper is to present the oddities faced by the women during their motherhood while they were enslaved into plantations, sometimes forcibly, sometimes by bad luck. The exploitation of women has been a hyped concern from long in Black literature, but this paper concerns towards their oppression, especially during their pregnancy, how they were treated even when they were pregnant. So I've tried to exhibit their physical and psychological exploitations by two novels, namely Toni Morrison's Beloved, which I also discussed earlier, and Solomon Northup's 12 Years a Slave, which is a memoir. The paper will conclude that we do not need to be Black to empathize with them. Rather, we need to treat them fairly equal, and with the aid of literature, should explore more about them. Okay, so the presentation, I have already said what are the contents: slavery and its effect on blacks, black literature, black women slaves, motherhood of enslaved black women, tormenting of their motherhood, Morrison's beloved, Solomon Northup's 12 Years a Slave, and a conclusion. So, black literature. Black literature is, of course, what we call as African-American literature, and it has the stories and incidents endured and protested by the natives of African colonies. Because of their skin color, they were racially discriminated and abducted into slavery, where they were made prone to brutalities and thrashings. So when we hear the term African literature, the first thing which comes in our mind eventually is black people, plantation, slavery, oppression, beating and thrashing. And I want to show this side of literature where we automatically land on these thoughts for African literature and culture. As I have said in my paper also, we do not need to be blacks so that we can empathize with them to feel how they were worn down mentally and physically. So slaves, slavery, slave narratives, these are a prominent part of African literature, and I have tried to cover this only. So the lives of the people abducted or eventually put into slavery was really pathetic. Black literature is solely dedicated to their sufferings and outcomings. So the African literature started towards the end of the 16th and 17th centuries, and the oppression of the blacks ended after many anti-slavery movements like Harlem Renaissance, Black Arts Movement, Abolitionist Movement, etc. African literature as a whole has always excited me, particularly the slave narratives, to know how they suffered, what they went through. As we know that the condition of women has always been on hype, and in slavery too, women have suffered a lot, especially the mothers. Many of the anti-slavery movements took place to avoid the oppressions the slaves go through. So A. Philip Randolph, a famous African-American writer, he wrote, "Salvation for a race, class, or nation must come from within. Freedom is never granted, it is won. Justice is never given, it is exacted. Freedom and justice must be struggled for by the oppressed of all the races and lands, and the struggle must be continuous." So he basically said that the blacks will have to fight for themselves. They will have to stand up for themselves. And so they eventually did. Martin Luther King Jr. said in his speech, "We are not fighting for integration, nor are we fighting for separation. We are fighting for recognition as human beings. In fact, we are actually fighting for rights that are even greater than civil rights, and that are human rights." So how pathetic it is that they had to fight for being recognized as human beings. They were not recognized as human beings. They were treated as products with price tags who were sold into slavery forcibly and with prizes, with certain prize money. So coming to the basic part of my presentation, which is the oppression of the mothers in slavery. So motherhood is a prodigious moment in a woman's life, which she cherishes for life. But the black slave woman could not feel the same. Their motherhood was considered as a business for the brutal white owners. It was a means of having more of laborers, as the children of a slave are eventually slaves, as we know. They were raped and molested even when pregnant. Workload remained the same. No extra food was permissioned, which would eventually deteriorate their health. The mothers were also equally treated as they had been treated. No special care, no special attention, or even basic attention was also not given to them. Seeing how they themselves were treated and given a life of hell, the mothers practiced infanticide. So it is how painful for a mother to kill her own children. But they had to practice infanticide so that they could give them a better life. Because after killing only, they can get a better life. So they had to practice infanticide. They would kill them after birth, or they would take herbal ways of tormenting their pregnancy so that at least the child could be saved from the harsh world, harsh realities of slavery, the brutalities of the owners. So these are the few images of slavery, how brutally they were beaten. in front of people and public. So now coming to the novel, first novel, which I have kept as one of the main purpose of discussion, Toni Morrison's Beloved. It was published in 1987, and it is based on a true event of an ex-slave, Margaret Garner. So she had killed her child to save her from the brutalities of slavery. So Morrison got to know this event, got to know about this story in a newspaper article. So after that, she took that idea from there and wrote a complete, a beautiful novel. So the novel is that Baby Suggs, she is an old lady when we start the novel. So she had 8 children, but all were products of, except one, all were products of his white masters. Of course, they were raped and sexually exploited, as we know. So all were the products of white owners. So she eventually killed all of them. And only Halle survived, as he was his husband's product. But Halle too was abducted into slavery, as her mother, Baby Suggs, was eventually a slave. So he had to go into slavery only. So all the 8 were eventually put into slavery. Seeth, now coming to Seeth, she is the major protagonist of the novel. So she was Halle's wife and the protagonist of the novel, as I said. She was raped and sexually exploited when pregnant. She was pregnant with her 4th child, Denver. And the nephew of the white owners, they sexually exploit her, even steal her milk, which is a woman's sole possession, which she keeps for her, only for her child. She was stolen of her milk. She tries to kill her 4 children to save them from slavery, but she could only kill her eldest daughter, which is named as Beloved, over which the novel has been named. So she later haunts her mother for killing her. So it's a beautiful novel which you should really read. I would really recommend people to read that novel. So she gets deteriorated. Seeth gets deteriorated physically and psychologically by the coming of her, by the return of her dead daughter. Now, see how she was brutally beaten. Seeth was brutally beaten by the owners when she complained about them for sexually exploiting her, for raping her, even when she was pregnant. So she was beaten brutally. This scar on her back, which is also, it has also a very significant role in the whole novel. It is a symbolical representation of how she was beaten. It has been called as the choke cherry tree, which is a symbolical representation of slavery, how slavery is rooted into her life and its branches grow, following her children also into slavery. The tree, as a slave mark, lives with her till life. The death of her child makes her socially distanced with all, and her return as a ghost deteriorates her psychologically. This is the image when she tries to kill her daughter. Now coming to another novel by Solomon Northup. It's not a novel, it's a memoir by Solomon Northup, 12 Years a Slave. So I think it's a very famous memoir. People would be really acquainted to it, of African literature. So after getting free from slavery, he wrote this memoir to tell people about his sufferings into slavery. He gets abducted into slavery forcibly, though he was a free man, but he was abducted into slavery by 2 white people. They told him about giving a job into Washington, D.C., and he trusted them. He went with them, but when he opened his eyes, he was in a cage, all chained. When he objected, he was beaten, thrashed. He was thrashed brutally by hunters and all that. So he is thrashed continuously, and even his name is changed. He is baptized as Platt. So his identity is tormented. People, blacks were also tormented with their identity. That is what Martin Luther King Jr. says, that we are on a search for our identity as humans. So they were changed, the names were changed so that others could not recognize them. So there is a character, Eliza, in the novel. She is another slave woman with Platt, with Solomon. So she is a mother of two children, a daughter and a son. So first she works as a slave for her owner, and she is as owner for him for 9 years. After his owner gets sick and dies, her sister, the owner's sister, sells her to the tradesmen, to the slave traders, and he sells her to another slave, and there she is distanced from her children as well, because the owner doesn't purchase the children also. He keeps the daughter, especially the daughter, to for other means. Her daughter is kept as a means for earning heaps and bounds of money by her beauty. So how, see, you can see how the girls were specially treated. Another character is Patsy, a girl slave at the plantation with Solomon. So she was daily raped by her owner. The wife of her owner, she was felt jealous of Patsy. Even she was a slave, and the white owner and the wife was a white woman, the owner, but still she felt jealous with Patsy, and she tortures her psychologically, psychologically beats her, torments her, all this. Yes. How Solomon says that I don't want to survive, I want to live. Some of the other slave narratives are Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom's Cabin, and it is also a famous slave narrative. So it is said to have laid groundwork for the Civil War. Another is Frederick Douglass's narrative of the life of Frederick Douglass. It is an autobiography of his slave life. He wrote his own life of slavery, how he too was abducted into slavery, and later he ran from the plantations. Next is William Styron's narratives of the life of Nat Turner, concerns the slave revolt in Virginia in 1831. Harriet Jacob's incidents in the life of a slave girl, autobiography of Jacob as a mother and a fugitive slave. Now, there are other writers who have to say about slavery. So Harriet Jacob lamented that slavery is terrible for men, but is far more terrible for women. So this is really very recognizable, that yes, women have to suffer because of their strength. They lack in strength, and they have to suffer everywhere. Eliza in 12 Years a Slave said, "I have done dishonorable things to survive. God forgive me." So for survival, she had to sleep with different people, she had to work for other people, and she still felt it dishonorable to do all these things, but she had to do it eventually to survive, to for herself, for her children. Abraham Lincoln said, "Whenever I hear anyone arguing for slavery, I feel a strong impulse to see it tried on him personally." So this is a good option. Toni Morrison said, "Freeing yourself was one thing, claiming ownership of that claimed self is another." So thank you, everyone. This was my presentation. And I want to conclude my presentation as that we can use literature to come up with more of American literature, to come up with more of knowing about their oppressions, knowing about their how they felt, how they were treated. Salman Rushdie said that literature is where I go to explore the highest and lowest places in human society and in the human spirit, where I hope to find not absolute truth, but the truth of the tale, of the imagination, and of the heart. So similarly, we too should exhibit more of African literature and explore the highest and lowest aspects of human society of the colored people. They have been the sufferers and the warriors themselves. So at least we can help them, fairly treat them by knowing their sufferings and making this genre more prominent in literature. So thank you, everyone.
thank you for the wonderful presentation once again. I would like to call Imo Okon Ekimeni Umoka Mary Okpong once again. If you are with us, sir, please continue with your presentation. We have been waiting for you for so long. Sir, if you are with us, please unmute the microphone and start your presentation. Since you were the first presenter, we have been calling you for so long. Sir, if you are with us, please unmute your microphone and start the presentation. Can you hear me, sir? Imo Okon Ekimeni Umoka Mary Pong, if you are with us, please start your presentation or at least respond that you are with us. Anyway, let us move on to the next presenter. Next presenter is Shaimol Matthew. Shaimol, are you with us? Shaimol Matthew is an independent scholar, independent researcher. Shaimol, are you with us? Shaimol, are you with us?
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Okay. Yes, you are audible. Okay. Please, okay. Please continue with your presentation. Okay.
Oh, okay. Thank you, sir. Good afternoon and good evening to all the participants. The title of my presentation is The Ongoing Labyrinth of Racism Among Mankind. Sir?
Yes, you are perfectly audible. Please go on. Please carry on. Perfectly audible. You are perfectly audible. Please carry on.
God created man in his own image, and man himself has disfigured God's reflected image through him by showing discriminating on the basis of color, ethnic groups, or beliefs. Even though our souls reach the pinnacle of education and technology, our attitude towards our fellow being is in perpetual darkness. Recently, I read about a Polish lady of African descent telling her story at a protest against racism, that for the first time she felt that she was different when she was 5 years old, when she was not allowed to play in a dollhouse as she is a Murzian. Murzian is an Polish racial epithet used to describe or address the black people. Khalid Hussain from Bangladesh highlighted his plight at the Durban society, and they are not even considered a citizen of the country. In South India, a frail tribal man was tied up and beaten to death, accusing him of theft by a group of young men. The recent incident of George Floyd, a black American who was killed by police brutally, highlights the perils of this racist culture. A few centuries ago, imperialism brought an impediment called racism among mankind. This world was built to attain power by the means of divide and rule. European colonizers needed laborers as they found gold, diamonds, and other precious metal in African countries. The African left their farmlands, village to work in their own God-given inheritance, thus developing the migrant labor culture, greatly impacting the culture and society. Caste system in India began with the arrival of the fair-skinned Aryans, who considered themselves superior to the inhabitants of this land. They disregarded the local values, beliefs, and pushed the local people towards forest and mountains. The skin color was an important factor in the caste system. The word Varna doesn't depict class or status, but skin color. A few acknowledged, but many more unknown incidents of racial abuse happen in India every day. The venom is instilled in human beings. Many glorified souls, remonstrated, protested to eradicate this virus, but it continues to spread and gets rooted in humans like the present day pandemic. Raising voice during protest, reading or writing against the ongoing system or any other means of objections may last for hours or days, and the society forges a new generation with the same virus or venom transfused to them. For Chinua Achebe, overcoming goes hand in hand with eradicating the destructive effects of racism and injustice in Western society. In his writing, Hope and Impediments, he tells us of the impediments that still stand in the way of open, equal dialogue between Africans and Europeans, between Black and the whites, but also instills in us the hope of overcoming this. Achebe has consistently argued for right of Africans to tell their own story through his novels. Many African writers like Maya Angelou, Ralph Ellison, she was speaking about Toni Morrison, and have been the voices of their generation who fearlessly exposed to racism, abuse, and segregation through their writings, who have left mark on the literary world forever. In his famous critic, An Image of Africa, Chinua Achebe takes a strong opinion against Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness. According to Achebe, Conrad is unkind to the native people in his novel and exposes them as savages who don't have language but grunts, sounds, and physical actions. To Achebe, Conrad's Heart of Darkness dehumanizes the African. In the literary domain too, racial inequality caused stereotyping and labeling of Black African writers in many ways. White authors, publishers dominated the literary environment while Black authors were insignificant. It is somber to perceive that the voices or emotions of these writers are not piercing enough to our souls and hearts. India is a country with diverse culture, biodiversity. It is multilingual too. As an Indian, I can see the concept of racism implanted in the roots of majority of the Indians. It can be color, caste, or creed, and it is evident in the attitudes of people. The obsession of fair skin in India is manifested in most sickening ways. The mass media plays a huge role in stereotyping Black people as miscreants. The media and entertainment industry remain biased and has not been able to embrace the full spectrum of nation's diversity, greatly the gender and color biases. The urge to pick light skin over dark is permeated in every atom of our society. Color somehow is identified to high class and greater social status. This is highly expressed in our consumers' behaviors as well as in advertising sector. Dark skin is a hindrance. And unless one attains fair skin, you cannot succeed in life. This is the message every fairness product company uses to get the consumer and the industry boons. There is an explicit preference for a light-skinned people in the television and film industries. It is an utter shame that many employees cannot wrap their head around the fact that someone can be dark and successful. It is basically fulfilling consumers' demand for the television audience. This is normalized, which makes it even more sickening. When a child is born with dark skin, he or she must go through the ringer because of the color. Even in schools, the child will be segregated with skepticism of skin and caste. The bride and grooms will be searched based on their skin tone, but not based on their character. India's caste system is perhaps the world's longest surviving social hierarchy, according to Human Rights Watch. The caste system firmly vanquishes in modern India. The community which I live depicts a clear picture of the caste system and their blind dogmas. Child marriage is one of the phenomena of the caste system. They marry off their children in the early age, citing to the fact that they won't get alliance from the same caste of the certain age. In some parts of India, outcast termed people are not allowed to get into the compound of higher hierarchy group, and the high caste do not join with Dalits during festivals. The outcast doesn't have access to certain temples. Physical and sexual abuse of Dalit women, gang rapes, sexual violence linked to debt, bondage in rural areas are the ugly pictures of racism and casteism in India. Many Dalit abuse cases are reported in the past 4 months, which involves even minors, but no action has been taken as they are unable to raise the voice and no one is there to support them. Religious intolerance is another side of the coin which is gaining momentum in India now. Increased incidents of religious fanaticism and discriminations are being reported across India. The death of George Floyd in America became a headline all over the world, but even worst episode of bigotry even gone unheeded and unaccounted for here in India. Many are entangled in the inhuman web of racism. The novel coronavirus or natural calamities strike everyone despite of their color, caste or creed. God doesn't show favoritism while pouring his blessings. Then what we are up to? Let me conclude with Nelson Mandela's quote, "No one is born hating another person because of the color of his skin or his background or his religion. People must learn to hate. And if they can learn to hate, they can taught to love. Racism is about making quick judgments on the physical characteristics of social association to rate them as inferior or superior and showing bias. Many ample voices of racism have been heard through novels, articles, journals, and speeches from many decades. Racism has become like a tangled web where many are entrapped. One may not understand the psychological trauma of many that facing while escape from this web. One can't ignore this or run away from, but must take a step to do with the social evil. Even in a democratic society, to hold on to the ruling power, the racial impression is being played on even now, today. Introspection becomes the first good step towards confronting racism. If one feels that there are seeds of racism in our words and deeds, a novel measure is required to be initiated. One social interaction must be of love and compassion without portraying her social status, so that this action may be imparted to the generation to come. Let the children, let our small children's readings be of social equality, empathy, and boosting of love towards humanity. The feeling of hatred is also the result that comes from our social affiliation. One must be the change that one expects to see. Take proactive, positive, and initial steps to model the all-encompassing love towards humanity. Advertisements connect fairness to every aspect of life, marriage, career, empowerment, goals. Social media platforms have come up with awareness movements, campaigns that portray that beauty is not the color of your skin. Petitions have widely circulated to ban existing ads and even companies that run on the fairness agenda. The recent decision of Unilever, the parent company of popular skincare brand Fair and Lovely, to remove fair and other words that banned associate to like whitening. Lightening is all step towards correcting the old age-old stigma. More and more people have begun to denounce colorist ideals these days and products that depicts the same. A recent example is Netflix series Indian Matchmaking, which greatly sparked a debate amongst the millennials as a protagonist, a matchmaker puts a skin tone as an important attribute for finding partners. Despite the fact that damage caused by colorism heightens every day, according to studies, this has got a long way to go before it is eradicated. Like-minded allies are formed on social media platforms who voice against colorist views, often these days making social media a key platform that can potentially play a great role in dismantling this sickening social issue. Over time, the younger generation will hopefully learn to reject old age racism and colorism and treat every individual for who they are, deep within, just the way the God intended them to be. Let's consider this pandemic and natural calamity as a sign from God to be in harmony. We all are one race, that is the human race. Thank you.
Thank you, Shaimul, for the wonderful presentation. Now I would like to call the next person, that is Simran. Simran from Punjab University, Chandigarh. Simran, are you with us?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, Simran, please carry on with the presentation.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Please carry on.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Simran, and my topic is racism in Black literature. So in this paper, I would like to talk about the issue made by the racism could be followed to the main consideration behind most of the Black literature through the ages. In America, this offered another type of scholarly articulation known as the Black American literature or African American literature. The principal worry of this subclass of writing is to reclaim the substance of the individual of color and his way of life from negative to a more positive heading. This examination rephrases the advancement of Black American literature from the 18th century essayist. So I would like to talk about my paper now. Black American writing or African writing is a term that alludes to an entirely of distributed writing in the US by journals of African plummet. This classification of writing is recognizable to the crafted by such late 18th century essays like Philip, Olaha. It got to his most noteworthy point with the slave stories and Harley Renessa, and proceeds with today with crafted by writers like Toni Morrison, Walter Mosey, who are perceived as the top authors in the US. As indicated by reference book Britannia, it is called the New Negro Development is a time of exceptional abstract power and investment that occurred during the 1920s. The difference in the deposition to the African American over the previous 100 of the years has similarly influenced the focus of the Black American literature. Essential focal point of this writing before the American Common War was on bondage, as the slave story demonstrate. This was changed at the turn of 20th century by the books of the warrior like Richard Rich, Steens, who underscored the issues of racial isolation and Black patriotism. Wikipedia says that African American writing has commonly centered around subjects specifically noteworthy to Black individuals in the US. For example, the job of African American inside the bigger American culture and being an American with that difference attribute of the American writing. Remember the situation of the Black Americans for the matter of opportunity. Paul Lawrence Dunberg is sorted under the post-subjugation time of scholars of the Black American writings. He regularly wrote in the rustic Black vernacular of the day. Dunberg was the principal African American artist to increase national unmistakable quality. His first book of verse, Oak and Ivy, was distributed in 1893. Quite a bit of Dunberg's work, for example, When Melinda Sings in 1906, which incorporates photos taken by the Hampton Institute Canberra Club and jogging and gives relieving looks into the rivers of Africa. Americans of the day, in spite of that fact that Dunberg passed on youthful, he was uncold. He was called a productive artist, writer, author, and a short story essayist. His work incorporated the uncouth 1898 and the fantasies 1901. He is additionally noted to have composed the vast majority of his sonnets in African tongue. A portion of his different works are the uncouth in 1898, the fantasies in 1901. For the greater part of his profession, Dunberg composed for a white crowd, and he for the most part kept away from racial issues as a subject. The Sport of the Gods is alluded to the Dunberg's most popular novel, Encarta, distributed first in 1902 by Dodd, Mead and Co., New York. The novel recounts an account of Black family in a northern City in the US of America. This family evidently experienced prejudice, subjugation, persuasion, and despite the fact that this looks exceptionally latent in the plot of the novel, Dernberg additionally composed four assortments of the short stories. And if I talk about investigation of Dernberg's The Sports of the Gods, I would like to say that part one of the novel, which discusses the Hamiltons, opens the purveyor to the days of the year of estates and supervisors, experts and the slaves. The little bungalow wherein Barry Hamilton lived as maid with his significant other Fanny, a child Joe and a girl Kitty, is strongly stood out from the house of his manager, which sat back somewhere in the range of 100 places. He was the one of the numerous slaves who, upon their increased opportunity, had not left the South, however, had mended here, and there is in many areas that posing and working and battling to ascend with their distorted fortunes. It was a lot later in the chapter, the novel, that Sports of the Gods that notices is made by the family once more. Books written by Black essayists carried the Black American writing to the spotlight, particularly from the 1970s, as more markets were made for them, and the writers similarly began winning various honors. Scholarists similarly recognized this type of writing inside this period as an acknowledged type of American writing. Writers like James Toni Morrison, who had the advancement of Black writing when she filled in an editorial manager for Random House in 1960s and 70s. Alice Walker, who composed The Color Purple, an epistolary novel, a book written in the type of letters, which recounts to the account of Celie, a young lady who is explicitly mishandled by a stepfather and afterward completed to wed a man who truly manhandles her, Alex Harley, Rashid Clark, Ashmil Reed, Jamaica, Randall Kinnan, and John Adler, among others, have carried this kind of writing to global acknowledgement. If I would like to conclude it with, like, I want to talk about the pundits of the Black American writing hold the view that while Black American writing is all about acknowledged in the U.S., there are such a large number of perspectives on its certainty, conventions, and hypotheses. The supporters of this type are of the view that this writing draws up out of the experience of Blacks in the U.S., particularly with the respect of noteworthy bigotry and segregation, and in an endeavor to dispel the predominant societies, writings, and forces, that is America and different Europeans. A group that balustrates the African-American writing considered it to be a piece of Black of American writings. There are likewise those in the African-American people group that despite the manner by which their writing at times depicted the Blacks. A few reactions leveled against the Black American writing throughout the years excluded from the African-American people group. Some portions of which is that Black writing does not sum off the time that depict individuals of color in the constructive light. Hope you will like my lecture and my research paper. And I'm going to end this. Thank you very much. Session 12 webinar, I have completed my presentation. Can you please take over?
Yes, we can hear you, Simran. Thank you for the presentation once again. So I would like to call Professor Shinjon Goswami. Professor Shinjon Goswami from Mathavanga College. Professor Shinjon Goswami. Sir, are you with us?
Yes, I'm with you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are perfectly audible. Sir, please continue with your presentation, sir.
Sir, sorry to interrupt. I would like to ask, is there any other form to fill?
Hello?
No, Simran, not right now. If there is, we will let you know.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please continue with your presentation, sir.
Okay, sure. Good evening, everyone. I'll be speaking to you about and on James Quest's novel, Waiting List, Remembering Now, Time, Trauma, and History in Waiting for the Barbarians. I'd like to begin with a quotation from George Agamben's essay, What is the Contemporary? Here goes. The entry point to the present necessarily takes the form of an archaeology that does not reach unlived element in everything that is lived. That which impedes access to the present is precisely the mass of what, for some reason, we have not managed to live. That ethnology in the 19th century West thrived on the growing prominence of hermeneutics as a method seminal to the formation and circulation of colonialist knowledge. Defined by scale-maker as understanding all foreign or strange speech, hermeneutics concretely project error, uncertainty, or absence of understanding as foreignness, and then treat that strangeness as a problem to be solved, a deviation to be disciplined. Indebted to this theoretical premise, colonial archaeologists dig into the origins of culture has traditionally been committed to the appropriation of an usage of historicism in theses on the philosophy of history. For Benjamin, historicism's objective commitment to recognize and transmit the past as it really was, an intuitive process of transmission as heritage necessarily excludes is something Benjamin identifies as the tradition of the oppressed. In lieu of historicism's vulgar naturalistic method of a real subjective relation with our histories in a way that Am I audible now?
Yes, sir, you are audible, but yes. There was a lot of distortion, okay. Sir. Yes.
Okay, sir, sorry for that. So history is not just a science, but as Benjamin puts it, but also a form of remembrance. What science has established, remembrance can modify. Remembrance can make the incomplete into something complete and the complete into something incomplete, unquote. Frequently criticized for being strategically placed in settings whose temporal, spatial locations resist easy determinations, J.M. Coetzee's early novels perform a complex critique of colonial archaeology's hermeneutic enterprise through their very affiliation with the allegorical. Etymologically derived from the Greek allos, which means other, allegory makes possible the art of speaking otherwise by consistently deploying a language at one remove from what it claims to represent. This paper argues that as a mode of not only representing but living with parallel narratives, the allegorical in Barbarians allows Coetzee to narrate the unenviable experience of being speechless before appetite. This is a phrase I have taken from the Coetzee scholar Sam Durant. even as the novel's central problematic of articulating the inarticulate mirrors the ethical impossibility of speaking for or as the other in the context of the protracted trauma of the South African apartheid. Barbarians, admittedly, refrains from directly invoking the political nightmares of the apartheid regime, not providing, for example, detailed descriptions of state-sanctioned killings such as that of the student leader Steve Biko in prison. However, in confiscating its own narratorial authority at the face of what Paul Ricoeur would call the time of the apocalypse, Barbarians bear testimony to the necessity of reimagining the political itself in terms of the ethical, an imperative to live beyond all living presence with the specters, the revenants of and arrivants of history, as Jacques Derrida puts it in Specters of Marx. Novelistically, what enables Coetzee to de-dramatize this non-contemporaneity of the present is the centrality to this particular novel of what Elaine Scarry's magisterial study calls the body in pain. According to Scarry, for the person in pain, pain signifies having certainty by its very immediacy, while for one witnessing and responsible for speaking on behalf of the suffering body, pain is so elusive that, I quote, hearing about pain may exist as the primary model of what it is to have doubt. Thus, pain comes unshareably into our midst as at once that which cannot be denied and that which cannot be confirmed. Whatever pain achieves, it achieves through its unshareability, and it ensures this unshareability through its resistance to language. For physical pain does not merely resist language, but actively destroys it, bringing about an immediate reversion to a state anterior to language, unquote. In its etymological signification as bodily wound, as well as in the sense of psychological catastrophe that the word's later associations accrued, repeated and various manifestations of trauma in barbarians augments Scarry's arguments regarding intense pain's destruction of language as we know it and the inaccessibility of those who have not suffered to either comprehend or narrate this language of pain that breaks down all our presupposed conceptions regarding the link between the signifier and the signified. In Waiting for the Barbarians, after the magister undergoes an othering of the self through the torture inflicted by Mandel and his troops, the lynch protagonist's terrified wailing is registered and ridiculed as the barbarian's nonsense. Quote, he's calling his barbarian friends, someone observes, that is barbarian language you hear, unquote. Pointing to the word's Greek etymology in an intertextual reading of Barbarians and the C.P. Cavapi poem from which Coetzee's novel takes its title, Mario Bolezzi states, and I quote, the ancient Greek word barbarian is supposed to imitate the incomprehensible language of the mumbling of foreign people, sounding like barbar, or as you would now say, blah, blah. As such, it has a double implication. On a first level, it signifies a lack of understanding on the part of the other, since the language of the other is perceived as meaningless sounds. At the same time, it suggests an unwillingness to understand the other's language and thus to make the encounter with the other a communicative occasion. Consequently, the term barbarian entails a collective construction of the other in a way that helps define the civilized subject itself. In this construction, the other is supposedly invalidated because it can never speak back and question its construction. The barbarian thus appears as an abjected outside, which, according to Judith Butler, is always inside the subject as its own founding repudiation, unquote. Butler's notion of the founding repudiation here, of course, recalls Edward Said's classic delineation of the Orient as Europe's dark double, the unconscious repository of everything the West finds reprehensible, ugly, culpable within itself. Barbarians, of course, allegorizes this classic case of colonial repression, but more pertinently for my argument, I would look at the language of the fisherfolk in Coetzee's novel and its links with the body in pain. The fact that the very untranslatability of the fisherfolk's language makes them culpable in the eyes of the colonial police, and that in the spectacle of the magistrate's humiliation, the cries of pain from a suffering body could become an object of ridiculous barbarian language, harks back to Benjamin's critique of the progressivist impulse in historicism, a particular time consciousness complicit with colonial self-fashioning that conveniently forgets the language of the oppressed as the tradition of the oppressed, since both this language and this tradition is constituted through continual suffering. As pointed out by Andrew, archaeologists believe that the backwardness Europeans encountered outside their country was firmly rooted in the past, perfectly complements Benjamin's critique of bad modernity's impulse of reifying and fixating the past if it is of no use in fashioning the present. Recalling the great exhibition of the natives in London during the early 1850s, Waiting shows its rootedness in this particular tradition of thinking history when its conscientious narrator tells Colonel Joel early in the novel, quote, "These are the only prisoners we have taken for a long time. Normally, we would not have any barbarians at all to show you," unquote. But the connection between hermeneutics and colonial archaeology traced out in the beginning of this paper is perhaps just dramatized in the gorgeous spectacle of the novel. As modernity's most sustained venture in producing otherness within the territorial borders of a home, apartheid in South Africa deployed spatial racial segregation to foreignness within the self, which is a reified image of the past, which in typically hermeneutical logic it could then study, decode, and banish for its self-legitimization. Embodying this negative image of the Enlightenment subject, the 12 fishermen drawn together in a horde at Joel's command are written onto and written off in hermeneutics performative gesture in a bloody spectacle, as the word enemy is inscribed on their back while they are beaten with a whip. Thus touching upon, indeed, on the immediate present of his situation as a South African novelist invested in the ethical, Coetzee would in the same novel problematize the contemporaneity of his witness by shifting the locale of his archaeological survey from the sandy dunes to the mute prison cells. For Agamben, contemporaneity is messianic time par excellence, and for Benjamin too, the historical materialist at odds with historicism's methods perceives the present as, quote, "the time of the now which is shot through with chips of messianic time," unquote. And since messianic time in Benjamin and Agamben thus suggests the immanence of an unlived future, it seems pertinent for me to read it together with Jacques Derrida's futural position and notion of justice and ethics in the context of Waiting. According to Derrida, just future depends on the coming one day, one night, several centuries later of another scholar, finally capable of reading the becoming body of the specter beyond the opposition between presence and absence, actuality and inactuality, life and non-life, of thinking the possibility of the spectra as possibility. Better, he would know how to address himself to spirits. In Coetzee's novel, Benjamin's anti-historicist conception of the past is filtered through a transformation in the magistral recognition of what archaeology as an ethical practice may entail. A lover of catalogues and collector of ruins unearthed by voluntary undertaken excavation in the sandy dunes, the magister's inability to listen to the ghosts of history in an early scene in the novel depicts a mode of thinking begotten by colonialist officialists, a point Coetzee makes clear by identifying the belief in the reality of ghosts with folklore and children instruction. That is a realm in which the presentness of the past survives as intuitive knowledge of the other. As Joel and Mandel's torture letter brings him close to the empire's others, the magistrate's awareness of the specters of history undergoes a radical reordering vis-a-vis his earlier imperviousness, shifting his gaze from the monument to the moment, learning not just to live with but speak and listen to the spectra as the scholar of a future yet to come. The confined magistrates dig into the mute prison walls, clearly thus the work of another archaeology. And I finish with a quote. "I stare all day at the empty walls, unable to believe that the imprint of all the pain and degradation they have enclosed will not materialize under an intent enough gaze, or shut my eyes, trying to attune my hearing to that infinitely faint level at which the cries of all who suffered here must still beat from wall to wall," unquote. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Professor Goswami. Got to know so many informations from your paper. It was really an enriching paper. Anyway, without wasting any more time, let us move on. And Next, I would like to call Shohini Sen. Shohini Sen from Calcutta University. Shohini, are you with us? Shohini.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Yes. Yes, please carry on.
Good evening to all the members present here, and thank you to Rishi Bunkim Chandra College for giving me the opportunity to present my paper. I'm Shohini Sen, and as the introduction has already been delivered, I'll straight away go to my paper. My paper is entitled as Untrammeled Spirit and Invincible Femininity, a Feminist Probe into Idols, the Girl Who Can. Since time is very stipulated, I have decided to break my paper down into significant points, which I'll be discussing in my presentation in as much detail as possible. I would like to begin my oral presentation with a very famous quote from the very famous novel Jane Eyre by Charlotte Bronte. The quote is uttered by the protagonist of the novel, Jane Eyre, and the quote is about Bertha Mason, the mad woman in the attic. The quote is as follows. Fearful and ghastly to me, oh sir, I never saw a face like it. It was a discolored face. It was a savage face. I wish I could forget the role of the red eyes and the fearful blackened inflations of the lineaments. Now, we all know that Bertha Mason was of an African origin, and to be more specific, she was of Creole origin, whereas Jane Eyre was English. These statements reverberated white supremacist and racist attitude towards Africa that continued for a long period of time till the Africans started raising their voices. Specifically, the line in the above mentioned statement, I wish I could forget the role of the red eyes and the fearful blackened inflations of the lineaments, metaphorically posits how the revolutionary white women of the contemporary time forgot the plights of the black women, and how the budding European feminism, popularly known as the first wave feminism, was racist and class-based. Now, black women were always, and in most of the time, discriminated in a multi-layered form. Now, this discrimination due to race and gender, popularly theorized through the term intersectionality by Kimberly Crenshaw, resulted in the rise of black feminism, which was a deviation from and the critic of the myopic white feminist movement. Amongst the various black women's voices that rose in unison against such multi-layered discrimination, one voice was of Ama Atta Aidu, the brilliant literary figure of Africa and the former education minister of Ghana. Now, Aidu was a staunch feminist, and her ideals of feminism are intricately interlinked with her ideals of nationalistic fervor. She opined that Africa's nationalistic cause would remain unattainable as long as the concerns of women remained unheeded. Now, out of her many works that have acquired critical admiration, this paper deals with Aidu's children's short story, The Girl Who Can. In this paper, I have explored how the story, The Girl Who Can, in its simple narrative, embodies some of Aidu's strongest feminist notions and her views regarding the socio-political position of African women. Now, before I begin my exploration, I would like to state what the story is about. The story is about the 7-year-old protagonist named Ochoa, who turns her limitations into her success. She is initially criticized by her narrow-minded grandmother, whom she calls Nana, not only for her intellectual exercise through schooling or her attitude and her revolutionary behavior, but also and mostly because of her bodily constitution of possessing two thin long legs, which according to Nana would be a hindrance to her later pregnancy in her later times. Now, when Ochoa wins the district competition championship in running, Nana's criticism turns into pride. Now, this is all the story is about, and the story begins with Aidu's exceptional focus on the fertile land of Hosotsi in Ghana, where the protagonist lives. Now, in my paper, I have connected the fertility of the land of Hosotsi with the intellectual and cultural fertility of the protagonist. And this I have justified through the tenets of ecofeminism, because ecofeminists make this relation between ecology and feminism, and they posit that a healthy ecology is reflective of a healthy society where men and women are at equal paces. Thereafter, Aidu does not confine her story to the fertile land, but makes a mention of the barren lands surrounding Hasotzi. That shows that there are indeed many African women whose intellectual, cultural, as well as artistic endeavors were still left to be explored. Now, by evoking the fertile land of Hasotzi as the backdrop to her entire story, Aidu deliberately subverts the colonial representation of Africa as a barren continent and its women as weaklings and illiterates. Thereafter, I have commented on the technicality of my short story, The Girl Who Can. The entire story is written in the first person narrative. Now, if we remember reception theory enunciated by Stuart Hall in his very famous essay, Encoding and Decoding in the Television Discourse, we would know that the interpretation of a text, according to Hall, the interpretation of a text depends on the reader's cultural background as well as the reader's subjective experiences. Now, since Aidu has incorporated first-person narrative in The Girl Who Can, it is thought to exude utmost relativity between the reader and the text, especially readers constituting African women readers, and thus the interpretation takes place at the most perfect level. Also, the title, The Girl Who Can, is suggestive and acquires a universality. It alludes to all those struggling girls who harbor huge potential but who are afraid to exercise their potential. The title and the narrative in the first person evoke a feeling of sodality between the reader and the text, especially the African women reader, and through the title it seems that Aidu is giving a message to all the women, to all the struggling women, be her African or non-African. She is giving a message to pursue their dreams and to giving her the encouragement that they can also aspire to become one of a kind. Now, the story being a harbinger of Aidu's feminist ideals, there are no male characters. It very interestingly revolves around three female characters belonging from three different generations. Nana, the protagonist's grandmother, Mammy, the protagonist's mother, and Ajoa, the protagonist herself. Now, through this characterization, Aidu seems to have evolved a process of transition from patriarchally manipulated mind to a revolutionary mind, because Nana is orthodox, autocratic, with a colonially and patriarchally insinuated mind. Mammy is a bit more progressive than Nana but silent, while Ajoa is expressive and inquisitive. Ajoa's inquisitive fervor makes her question every ideology that dedicated itself to fetter women. The very statement Ajoa utters in the beginning, "And my problem is that at this 7 years of age, there are things I can think in my head, but which maybe I do not have the proper language to speak them out," shows that how the voice of the African women were not only colonially manipulated, but also patriarchally dominated. Now, Nana, being established within orthodoxy, as I already mentioned in the beginning, she fervently dismissed Ajoa's intellectual enhancement through schooling, thinking it to be a waste of time. Now, on the other hand, Mammy, who is situated within the patriarchal institution but harbors liberal ideology, Aidu shows how this liberal ideology of Mammy is still in the nascent stage, because she encourages Ajoa schooling but only for writing her name and calculations. Now, as I was saying, that the voice of the African women were dominated not only by patriarchy but also by colonialism, Bell Hooks, in her book Black Looks, Race and Representation, has stated about this conspiracy by the colonials. Like Aidu, she vehemently criticizes the conventional representation, saying, "Opening a magazine or book, turning on the television set, watching a film, or looking at photographs in public spaces, we are most likely to see images of Black people that reinforce and reinscribe white supremacy." This white supremacy was not only colonial but also patriarchal. Stuart Hall, again in his essay Cultural Identity and Diaspora, has fortified this basic relationship between subjugation and representation, where he has stated that representation plays a very important role in cultural subjugation as well as colonial subjugation. And thereby quoting him, he stated that this subjugation and representation is the critical exercise of cultural power and normalization. Aidu's narrator, as can be seen through her inquisitive fervors, through her questions, through her self-belief, and through her revolutionary attitude, thus distinguishably subverts the colonialist and patriarchal notion and asserts a genuine picture of African women. Now, third wave feminism, I have particularly incorporated the tenets of third wave feminism in my paper because third wave feminism proposed a discourse where they associated female bodies with its political stance. This concept of body politics, that is associating women's worth with their capability of producing children, a typically patriarchal notion, is shown through Nana's censure of Adjoa's thin long legs that according to the former will be unstable for carrying children in the future. Nana says, legs that have meat on them with good calves support solid hips to be able to have children. Now, this is the colonial as well as a patriarchal mindset, which Aidu particularly criticized in her essay, Not Only in The Girl Who Can, but also in her essay, African Woman Today, where she talked about the representation of African women as a savage, half naked with sagged breasts, which resulted from breeding too many children, and which was considered by the cosmopolitans to be the only aim of the African women. Now, this is an example of dominant ideology fueled by patriarchy. But Adjoa in The Girl Who Can is portrayed as a strong girl, never ceasing to believe herself and contradicting Nana by questioning while her mother remains silent. Now, Mammy, Adjoa's mother, is like all those women who were confined to domesticity, who were voiceless, who did all the course according against their choices, but they remained silent, about whom Betty Friedan talked about in The Feminine Mystic, which is considered to be the perpetrator of the second wave feminism. Now, Aidu metaphorically showed this liberation of the women, of these voiceless women, by creating Adjoa against Mammy, Adjoa with her invincible spirit and indomitable expressiveness. Thus, Adjoa has effectively become Aidu's spokesperson. Next, I have talked about Pan-Africanism because Aidu's feminist notions were intricately interlinked with Pan-Africanist ideal. Now, what is Pan-Africanism? Pan-Africanism is or was an ideology that attempted a solidarity between regional Africans and Africans in the diaspora. But this Pan-Africanist ideal neglected the position of women in it, and Aidu was extremely perturbed with this stance by the Pan-Africanism. Thus, Aidu created a number of archetypal female characters embedded in Pan-Africanism ideal, like Essie in her novel Changes, Sissy in Our Sister Killjoy, Anova in the eponymous work, and many others. She believed that only a woman-centered Pan-Africanism will be able to progress Africa in her nationalistic stances. Now, in The Girl Who Can, since it is a children's short story, Aidu has never explicitly expressed her notions, but she has subtly hidden them in the text. In The Girl Who Can, the spatial movement within the plot reflects Aidu's Pan-African ideals. Like Adjoa's daily journey to the school, which is 5 kilometers away from her house, metaphorically shows her journey outside her comfort zone to a place where she gains knowledge of life, where she gains knowledge about the outside life, which is a Pan-Africanist ideal. Then, when she came first in district championship, she became known all over her district, which is a metaphor for recognition of Africa globally. Now, these plot movements have been paralleled with two underlying metaphorical movements. Adjoa's movement towards self-discovery, when she won the championship in running, she discovered that she has abilities in her, and those are not only feminine ability, but ability as a strong individual. And also very effectively, the plot movement parallels Nana's movement towards decolonization and liberalism. Nana in the beginning was autocratic, orthodox and patriarchal, but when Ochoa wins the competition, she changes 180 degree. She becomes liberal, she accepts the ideals, and her mind undergoes decolonization. This movement of Nana is shown through her acknowledged pride in her granddaughter's winning of the tournament of running. Her statement is, state her statement, which she utters when she sees Ochoa winning the race. She states that even though some legs don't have much meat on them to carry hips, they can run. Thin legs can run, then who knows? This particular statement implies Nana's embracing of Black ideals and her reception of the fact that women are not meant to be fettered but to fly. Now, running is very cleverly sought as a metaphor by Aidu, and she has used this running to show women, to make women knowledgeable about their relentless pursuit of their dreams, to not to look back. She is urging the women to not to look back, to not to be confined, but to pursue their dreams without without taking anything into consideration. Now here, Africa and Ochoa has also been connected. Just as the narrator transcends all the hurdles, so does the author think that her Africa will transcend all the misrepresentations by the colonialists to become an ideal nation. And indeed, Africa is progressing in such stance. Now, the fact that Africa and Ochoa is alliterative further proves this point, and it is through this connection between the continent and the narrator, between the continent and the strong woman, that the relativity between Aidu's feminist principles and nationalistic fervors can be concluded. As a conclusion to my presentation, I would like to read it directly from my paper. To honor Blackness and to believe in the potentiality of Black women are the messages Aidu conveys through her simple tale in The Girl Who Can. The story is of invincible femininity, unconquerable feminine spirit, and the act of transcending the hurdles triumphantly. Chandra Talpare Mohanty had talked about the concept of third world difference in her very famous essay Under Western Eyes, where the third world women were considered as homogeneous, powerless group. Aidu's story breaks this restrained perspective and establishes African women as powerful and individual human beings. Her feminist ideals propagated through the story pose an open challenge to patriarchy and colonialism, as well as serve as an introspective account to all those colonially manipulated minds of Africa. Thank you.
Thank you, Shohini, for this beautiful presentation. And next, I would like to call Sriporna. Sriporna from RBC College, Noihati. Sriporna, are you there?
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, Sriporna, please carry on.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Good evening, sir. Good evening, everyone. I'm now going to present my PPT on which I'm working. Okay, so my topic is Okonkwo, a tragic hero, and cultural conflict in Achebe's Things Fall Apart. Things Fall Apart is the novel by Nigerian author Chinua Achebe, published in 1958. Achebe was a writer who was always concerned about Africa's lost cultural values, which was the pride of African society. In his many writings, he has expressed his urge about the rising and awakening of African society, in an urge of reforming its lost cultural values, which was destroyed after the arrival of the Britishers. Africa had its own cultures, beliefs, law, ideology, morals, discipline, which were completely different from Western world. The novel Things Fall Apart had shown how the social, cultural, and political change after the colonization affected the life of people and how their life became shattered and their independence was gone and how helpless they were before the power of colonizers. Actually, Things Fall Apart is an antithesis of those writing of European writers who always showed African culture and people as wild, as having no cultural values, or as barbaric and civilized. For example, Conrad's Heart of Darkness. There, in that novel, Conrad has expressed his opinion about African people as it has portrayed the Africa as the other world. Here in the novel actually portrays an Africa and African society who owes their own culture, beliefs, rules, discipline, administration, thoughts and customs just like Western people have their own. HB has protested against the statement of Conrad and like writers of Conrad who has always expressed their hatred and always humiliated African people. And an image of Africa, racism in Conrad's Heart of Darkness is a writing of HB where he called Conrad a racist who was unkind to the people of Africa. Actually, he has strongly criticized Conrad's way of describing African people in Heart of Darkness. So my next topic is Okonkwo, Tragic Hero. Okonkwo is the protagonist of the novel Things Fall Apart. He's a very famous and popular throughout the nine villages. He achieved his fame through his work and achievements. Okonkwo achieves his fame in wrestling by defeating Amalins, the cat, who has been unbeaten for 7 years. Okonkwo is rich with crops and has 3 wives and children. Despite his fame, achievements, qualities, and hard working, he suffered and his ultimate destination was to sacrifice his life. He had done some mistakes or it can be said that his fate was also responsible for bringing him in our situation. One of the main reasons behind his downfall was his fear of being called weak, his fear of being called like his father. This fear led him commit some sins or mistakes which brought his downfall and suffering. To overcome this fear, Okonkwo did everything to prove his masculinity or his masculine nature. His first mistake was to beating his third wife for her carelessness in her week of peace. Beating wives was normal in African tribal society. Unless someone beat his wife in her week of peace, because they believed that beating wives in week of peace might unsatisfy their goddess of earth. And his second mistake was supporting the killing of the boy who was borrowed by another tribe to Umofian clan. The name of that boy was Ikemefuna. The boy lived with the family of Okonkwo for 3 years, and during this, the boy became a family member of Okonkwo's own family. But eventually, the oracle declared about the killing of the boy. But in spite of being called father by that boy, Okonkwo participated in the death ritual for just not being called weak. And Noi, his own son, went against his father for this action because he found cruelty in his father's nature and as well as the rituals and customs in his own tribal society, own tribal society or Igbo society. And his third mistake was killing Isidu's 16 years old son accidentally in a funeral. For this mistake, his clan gets 7 years exile on 7 years of exile. His exile as his punishment. The last nail was put into the coffin when missionaries came to Umofia and started to convince people about the new religion. Okonkwo's 7 years of exile in his mother's village shattered all his ambition about his position in his clan, and the news of new religions arriving in his clan and converting people, even his own son Noe, broke his last ray of hope. Okonkwo returned to his clan after the exile and witnessed the change. He no longer held the position and status he held before colonization. People of his clan no longer respected him like before. He had lost his popularity. In spite of all these, Okonkwo was determined to protest against the new religion. The leaders of the clan, along with Okonkwo, led people to tear up the church building and got arrested. After the release, the clan held up a meeting, and even in there, Okonkwo could not control himself and out of rage killed a court messenger. This incident with his tragic end, and the people also refused to support him or stand beside him, and Okonkwo hanged himself for not being caught in the hands of white people. Like every tragic hero, Okonkwo's own characteristic folly made him the victim. His folly was his ego of being a male, and the mistake of always establishing his masculinity. He had a fear that he always had to prove his masculinity or people will call him weak. And in the process of establishing this masculinity, he commits mistakes or sin again and again, which separated himself from his clan and even his own son Noe. He could not control himself, and whenever there is a meeting or there is a gathering or any rituals performed, he acted like a madman in the process of proving his masculinity. So it is his great fault which brings his downfall. My next topic is cultural conflict between Christianity and Igbo culture. Umofia has its has their own culture, that is the Igbo culture. They were very religious. They have multiple god and goddess, and the Igbo society was based on family tradition and father-son inheritance. Igbo culture had some superstition or evil beliefs. The society was knitted with tradition, heritage, laws, superstition, oracle, religion, gods, and evil smiths. It was the religious faith of Igbo community which governed them to their moral values and united them together. They had their own spiritual thought, which was full of God, forefathers, oracles, personal god or chi. But the arrival of new religion in their community shattered their unity and belief in their religion, which was the center of their culture and society. Religion was a very strong weapon to fulfill the colonialist motive of Europeans. The missionaries started to convert people who belonged to low category. They started to question their belief about the existence of their God, about their religion, about their customs, about their tradition, and everything. They marked their belief and rituals God as false. In this way, the Christian missionaries separated the converts from their own religions, from own religion and own community and society. Not only this, but the religious change not only the religious change, but the new religion also changed the traditional gender roles in Igbo society. Suppose the wife beating was a very common tradition or a masculine trait in African society, but these were not accepted in Western society as the sign of masculinity. Thus, the two opposite culture was clashing with each other. One was the masculine and other was the feminine. Okonkwo's own son took the Christian religion. Okonkwo was much saddened by the fact because Okonkwo's own son found humanity, peace, brotherhood in that in the new religion. So the clash begins in the house of Okonkwo himself. Thus, the two opposite culture, feminine and masculine, was completely different from one another, and it was very difficult for the one to accept another. Conclusion, in his writing, he had played the role of a teacher who taught his people how to regenerate in them the lost beliefs and values of their religion, culture, and how to reawake again to redeem the traditional African society, which was broken during colonization. According to Achebe, an artist must be in search of his society's history, and by knowing the history of his society, the artist can light up the torch to its society's past and can direct his society to its present and future in a more better way. For him, a novelist's major role is to be a teacher who will govern and direct his society. So in this novel, Achebe actually has portrayed the true picture of African society, and he had blamed the missionaries and Christianity for breaking the tradition for shattering their unity and for declining their cultural values. Achebe also suggests his people to take good things from the missionaries and concern themselves again to redeem their lost values, which was destroyed in the time of colonization. Thank you.
Thank you, Sriporna, thank you for your presentation. It was beautiful and colorful as well. Anyway, now
GPT was visible.
Yes.
Okay, it was sir. Thank you.
Okay. Now I would like to call Sriya Dash from Vishwabharati. Sriya, are you?
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Please carry on.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are audible. You are perfectly audible. Please carry on with the presentation.
Sir, please confirm once. Am I audible or not?
Yes, you are audible, Sriya. You are audible.
Okay. So the title of my paper is From Sentiment to Resistance, Locating the Joys of Motherhood in the Oppressive Forces of Race and Gender. In her works, Buchi Emecheta forges vehement protests against the oppression and powerlessness that are manifested in the lives of the poor and the black.
Sriya, please 1 minute. Sorry for interrupting. Sriporna, please stop.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, sir.
Carry on, Sriya.
Okay, sir. In her works, Buchi Emecheta forges vehement protests against the oppression and powerlessness that are manifested in the lives of women, the poor, and the black. Being a Nigerian female writer, Emecheta strongly opposes the passive role given to women due to patriarchal sexual bias. So, apart from criticizing colonialism and racism, she highlights the issue of gender as a basis for sexual rights. Taking cue from this, we can proceed to explore how the novel documents the subjugation based on race and gender, whereby portraying the integral relation between the protagonist's existence and her social and historical context. The Joys of Motherhood is among Buchi Emecheta's most pivotal works, which brings forth a strong female standpoint against male chauvinism and patriarchal unfair and oppressive attitude towards women. The story begins with the relationship between Enugu's mother, a strong independent woman, and her father, a chief. Enugu, however, accepts her father and her husband's authority over her. When her first marriage dissolves because of her inability to conceive, her father arranges for her to migrate to Lagos to marry a man none of them has ever met. She ultimately discovers herself living with an overweight, beer-drinking white man's boy, whom she is forced to love because a man is never ugly. What we see is that Enugu fulfills her purpose in life and all social obligations by eventually bearing 9 children. Emecheta portrays her intense struggle to earn money by selling matches, gathering firewood in order to feed her children and even to support one son through university. Her husband gives her sporadic assistance at his pleasure and at his pleasure takes junior wives with whom she must learn to live compatibly regardless of her own personal choice. At the level of realistic narrative, Emecheta tends to present problems that afflict a woman because of her unperturbed adherence to tradition. The problems of polygamy, jealousy among wives, the problems of a childless wife in a society that honors fertility, the problems of women married to weak men, and the problems of widows are some of the vital issues that Emecheta addresses in this novel. The mother figure is described in a variety of situations, be it in her sacrificing for her children or fighting with her husband in order to get financial support for the children, or protecting her children from their father's wrath and so forth. The figure of the mother therefore emerges as an indomitable figure who can move to any extent for the sake of her children and family. Instead of giving an idealistic image of motherhood, Emecheta records the troubled and the chaotic moments in a mother's life. Gender oppression thus appears to be no less painful than racial oppression. Being doubly marginalized, the black woman faces turmoil and anguish in a far more severe way than the men in the traditional Igbo society. The traditional world of the novel appears to discard alternative perspectives, which Emecheta resists. Women of Nigeria are forced to submit to the patriarchal ideology of sharing husband. Agunba got hurt because Akpati slept with Ona in the same hut where she once slept. Akpati enjoys rights because he's a man, and Agunba sided he succumbs to death. Death is the only option left for her. It is an example showing how men and women are stuck to gender hierarchization. Agunba's cry remains unheard, however. The European colonization of Africa in the 19th century brought about a series of social, cultural, economic, and political changes in Nigeria. In the novel, Emecheta carefully depicts the way in which the colonial discourse brings about changes in the colonized city, which reinforces native patriarchy to make women even more silent and oppressed than before. What Emecheta discloses is the recolonization of women in Lagos since the post-colonial state continues the oppression by the colonial regime instead of bringing any kind of improvement. In this regard, Anya Lumba explains that colonialism intensifies patriarchal oppression because the native men increasingly disenfranchise and exclude women from the public sphere and become more tyrannical at home. Being disempowered and humiliated by the British master, Enif takes out his frustrations on Enugu. His master calls him baboon while laughing and repeating the word, which echoes the inhuman treatment of the Oriental other by the West. The British master treats Enaif as if he is stripped of any cultural or historical formulation. Here, Emecheta attempts to question Western humanism. To conclude, Emecheta counters Western feminism by giving a jolt to the idea which regards women as a universal category. She rather demystifies the underlying layers of oppression, which echoes the understanding of Alice Walker in the context of Black women. There seems to be a presence of Emecheta's personal identification with the characters in search of their individuality. By doing away with the third-person pronoun she employs in her works, Emecheta in this novel utilizes the first plural, the first-person plural, I quote, we. This is an effective technique which intrigues the readers into the collective consciousness of the novel. The joys of motherhood is a form of resistance to the perpetual oppression inflicted on women, and it is this stance that contributes to the formation of vital premises of Black feminism. Thank you.
Thank you, Sriya Dash, for a wonderful presentation once again. It was a beautiful presentation, Sriya. Anyway, let us move on. Now I would like to call the next speaker, Shruti S. from the University of Kerala. Shruti?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are perfectly
okay, sir.
Audible. Please carry on.
Okay, sir. Mm-hmm. Sir, can you see my screen?
No, are you trying to deliver a PowerPoint presentation?
Yes, sir.
But it is not showing anything yet.
Okay. Is it now visible, sir?
Yes, now it is visible. Please carry on.
Okay, sir. Good evening, one and all. I'm Shruti S. from Department of Commerce, University of Kerala. The topic of my presentation is Culture, Language, and Evolution of African Literature. Literary art scholars may want to interrogate the necessity of beginning this paper with a definition of the term literature. For one thing, there are almost as many definitions of literature as there are writers. Another thing is that, assumedly, everyone in the literary studies knows what literature is and can attempt a functional definition of the term. However, for a common understanding and to give us a working definition, we shall adopt the definition of literature as written material such as poetry, novels, short stories, essays, etc. And also, the literature can, however, be seen as a use or manipulation of language tool, which is the best form for the purpose of exploring human experiences in diverse situations. The empirical study of any language by this means cannot be accomplished except its literature component is explored via. Literature is usually the creative works of the best brains in a particular language and culture. And next, we move on to the literature and linguistic evolution. The literature and linguistic evolution, it is a known fact that literature impacts on linguistic development. In the Chiyol Akyabe's translation of a loco-lobe expressions into English in a way that it is peculiar, for instance, has taught the literary word a new linguistic phenomenon which soon become popular among and inspired African writers. This linguistic thoughts of another society whose mother tongue is different. And also, in the Waltz Inca has also explored the technique of more or less translation when he translated English. And also, we could see that the African thoughts appreciated by all readers across the globe because of some of these works have been akin by who writes mostly African themes. And next, we move on to literature as a vehicle for cultural dispersal. Until recently, the history, only the Western literatures were recognized and studied for academic, moral, and intellectual upliftment, while African literature, which was fairly new, had not been seen as a field or any serious contemplation and scholarship. The African literature, which was viewed as emanation from the underdeveloped world was therefore considered as unworthy of any attention. There were even arguments in some quarters as to whether Africa has literature or oracle, since the bulk of what was seen as African literature and the Western universal concepts says that the captured by both set in the vesicle of the earth and the phenomenon in orientation as parts of their literary contributions to the decolonization of Africa. The history of Africa as presented by European scholars had been encumbered with malicious myths. It was even denied that we were a historical people, such displaying account which has been given of the positive deliverance of the ancestors. As a reaction against this imperialist word and its attitude to the African, he wrote that the things fall apart in 1958. And next we move on to literature and negativism. Negativism can be seen or located in the context of negative feelings or perceptions against normal human nature and cultural heritage of people different from one's peculiar group or race. History has been manipulated in some cases to promote this negative tendency used to oppress other human groups to score cheap political point of showing the false cultural superiority of one's race over another. And also in the history, we could see that they are rather led by the historical fallacies peddled in the pre-colonial and colonial era, blinded by colonist intentions. Up to the present era, that is the contemporary era, the colonialist works, how else could their denial of the Meritel Nobel Prize for Literature, which has been tackled by who is known by the dean and the Nobel Prize because his works attack the colonialism in spiritually warped imposters. And the literature demands a patient study and understanding of the African situation and culture before the advent of the white people. It was not a long night of barbarism and listless, mindless as portrayed by the Western European. Those who claim to be the originators of literature have all the while manifested much of inane ignorance of what literature is intended to achieve in human life. And next, they are rather led by the historical fallacies peddled in Europe, the pre-colonial and the colonial era, blinded by the colonist intentions. Up to the present, that is the contemporary era, the West has demonstrated that saying that old habits die hard by still manifesting the bias against African anti-colonialist works. And the conclusion of my study is that apart from being a tool for linguistic development, it is also an asset in building mankind up morally and in erecting intellectual bridges, thus making mankind wiser and better citizens of the world. This is the view of the world now turning into a global village where all people are expected to begin to exhibit singular willingness to see things from a general perspective as members of one large human community rather than from individuals' narrow points of view. It is from this perspective of literature that the world could become a better place for mankind to live in and be able to function safely and freely, generate and galvanize knowledge base and understanding and enhance better human relations on the global scale. From this perspective, one cannot but accept the fact that the full potential of literature has not been explored in the human community. Thank you. Thank you, sir, for giving me the opportunity to present my paper.
Thank you, Shruti. Now I would like to ask Hindul Palit, Professor Hindul Palit from Rashtraguru Surendranath College of Barakpur, to please continue with the question answer session. Sir, please take over.
Professor Dhar, am I audible and visible? Could you please confirm?
Yes, you are audible and visible. Please carry on.
Okay. Actually, we have so many questions. Actually, I was actually writing down all the answers in the chat box, which I'm going to read out. First of all, let me first thank Professor Dhar because he has been handling this session for so long. And I was quite late in joining. My apologies for that. Now we have a few questions. First, we have, I think there's a question. Shubhangini ma'am, are you there? Ma'am, if you are there, please unmute yourself. Shubhangini, ma'am, are you there? Professor Dhar, can you please confirm if she is there or not?
Shubhangini, hello, Shubhangini Priyodarshi, are you there?
Is she there?
I think she is there. Perhaps she...
I think there are quite a few questions.
Yes, yes, now she has unmuted. Yes.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Shubhangini, there is a question. There are, I think, two questions for you. Should I read that out for you?
Shubhangini, please unmute. Shubhangini, please.
There is a question for you.
Hello.
I think her network is a little dodgy. Yeah. Shubhangini, can you listen to me?
Yes, yes.
I think we should give her some. Yeah, okay. There is a question for you. I think Sreyoshi Dasgupta has written this. Thank you for the paper, Shubhangini. I have a question. You spoke of Beloved. Do you find memory, as treated by Morrison in Beloved, plays an important role for the recovery of history, healing of personal loss, and Sid's obsessive relationship with her children? Sid could still bear the brutality of slavery, but broke down under the pressure of memory of slavery. Thus, it would be very nice if you may talk about memory as a narrative tool as treated by Toni Morrison. Thank you. Shubhangini, if you are there.
I think Shubhangini is having some problem with her connection. So we should move on and ask.
Problem. Her. Yeah, yeah, right, right. Okay, right. Professor Goswami, are you there? Is Professor Goswami is there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. So there is an observation. Yeah, it's a wonderful presentation. I mean, absolutely, I'm just overwhelmed by your presentation. Got to learn so many things. One line that I just want to mention. In your presentation, you have just used this line. You have just said this line. Pain has its immediacy. Pain is illusory. Okay, so could you please elaborate upon that?
Am I audible?
You're absolutely audible.
Okay, sure.
Absolutely, you're audible.
So yeah. I was borrowing from Ellen Scarry's formulation in her book Body in Pain, that pain has a weird kind of relationship with language. That pain makes you revert, the person undergoing pain makes you revert to a position, a sound anterior to language. Like when you scream, when you torture, you're getting a beating or getting tortured, then the sounds that you make are not exactly language. So pain reduces us to our animality in a sense. Like we do not understand when animal screams or animal sounds many of the time. Pain makes us takes away our humanity by taking away our language, our meaning making, our rational, the rational element in our language, the rational element in our meaning making sentences. So that is what I was talking about. And so the paradox of writing what one has not suffered, you know, that dog squids in not just in Waiting for the Barbarians, but in all his novels, that I was referring to.
Right.
So how to get around the paradox novelistically?
Thank you so very much, sir.
That is the question. Yeah.
Right. Thank you, sir. Okay. I'm moving on to the next question. Shohini Sen, ma'am, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Hello.
Shohini. Okay. Madam, so it was a wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
There's an observation that brilliantly explained how constant proliferation of televised images go on to create racial prejudices. And I absolutely love the way that you talk about the limitations of, you know, first wave feminism. That's beautifully articulated. If you'd like to speak about a few more words on this, you know, this idea of televised images, how they are creating such certain bias. If you'd like to speak a word on that.
Yes.
Yes, this idea of televised image, you see, this was one of the colonial, I would say, masterstroke, because the colonized people, they when slavery started in 17th century, the slaves were brought to the coastal areas of Africa, and major parts of the Africa were unknown to the cosmopolitans. And thereafter, when the scramble for Africa happened in the later 19th and early 20th century, despite Africa being colonized, the colonial minds, like the whites, especially as the contemporary superpower, they presented this image of Africa as the barbaric people, illiterates. They presented this image in order to justify their white man's burden, in order to justify the fact that they were the master, that the colonization was absolutely needed, that they were the most civilized people of the world, and thus they are perpetrating this colonialism in order to make the world, the lesser known regions, civilized. And since Africans themselves had a, I would say, quite a glorious past, they had their own culture, they had their own orator and literature in their own form. So this difference, not only the physiological difference of the people living there, but this cultural difference, this difference was not accepted by the whites. It is a major, is majorly due to their psychological condescending of the African people due to the skin color and also their physiological difference. So they easily termed them as barbaric, and therefore they justified, in order to justify their colonization and in order to justify to the world that they are the most civilized, and that colonization is an important aspect needed by these third world countries, they propagated these televised images.
Right, right. Thank you so very much, ma'am. It's very well explained. Okay.
Thank you.
Now there is a question. Thank you, ma'am. Now there is a question for ma'am Sharmila Zazudia. Ma'am, are you there? Is she there? Sharmila, ma'am, are you there? Professor Dho, can you please tell me if she's
there? Sharmila Zazudia, ma'am, are you there, ma'am? Sharmila Zazudia, ma'am, are you there? I don't think she, I mean, she might be there, might be.
I think she has a
connection. Anyway, you can move on to the next question. Anyway,
Okay. There is a question for Professor Shubhai Chakraborty. Somebody has sent me this question. Do you agree? Professor Chakraborty is there?
Yeah, I'm there. Can you hear me?
Okay. So there is a question. Yeah, absolutely, sir. Sir, there is a question for you. Do you agree to this observation that Black Panther as a comic character is a creation of European imagination?
Okay, very, very interesting question. Now, you have to clarify two things. Firstly, are we talking about Black Panther the comic book, or are we talking about Black Panther the film? Now, let me first work on Black Panther the comic book. If you look into the history of Black Panther the comic book, it was first came out during the 1960s in Fantastic Four. If I'm not mistaken, it's in the 52nd or 54th volume of the Fantastic Four, and the creators were Stan Lee and illustrator was Jack Kirby. Now, if you look into Black Panther, we have to understand the genesis behind, I mean, creation of Black Panther. Firstly, because if you look into the basic comics, you would find that comics are obviously a cultural product, and there is a basic problem with issues of race and color. And initially in the comics, you wouldn't find any black characters. In fact, there were only whites, and the yellows were regarded as the, I mean, darker characters with darker shades. Now, with the introduction of black characters, I mean, Stan Lee and Jack Kirby, I mean, this is a very kind of a hegemonic way of thinking, right? I mean a discourse that they're intending to do. If you look into America became a land of opportunities. As a result, a lot of migrants came into America to have a better kind of living. And obviously, even Superman's creators, Joe Shuster and Jerome Siegel, they were also migrants. Now, when these people, they all came into the America, here the blacks and the whites, they coexisted together. Now, obviously, if you look into, I mean, public publishing industry is obviously at the honcho of, you know, asking people to buy books. And when they found that there were a sizable amount of black people around, they started creating, obviously of African origin, then obviously it was the main reason why they wanted to create a black kind of a superhero. Now, so it is not Eurocentric, rather it is more of the Americanized way of looking at it. Now, if you look into the film as well, you would find that there is a basic, you know, binary, a difference between the hero Shala and you have Eric Killmonger, who is more into the indigenous African way of thinking. And if you look into the representation of Wakanda, I mean, it was shown that, I mean, even in the comic books as well as in the films, you would find that it is portrayed as something which has a scientific superpower, which is practically impossible in a place like Africa. So, in one way, Black Panther is a wish fulfillment of all the Africans who wanted to see their a person of their skin to be a hero. On the other hand, it is a kind of an imposition of pop culture, about which I have already spoken in my paper when I was talking about Aya. So you find an infiltration of pop culture where people are being induced in buying comic books. I mean, that is the main reason I believe in, you know, having a black hero.
Right. Thank you, sir. It's very well explained. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Hello, I think Shubhangini Priyadoshi is here with us.
Yes. Okay, so could you please rephrase that? Yeah. So, Bikina, will you please put the question, or should I do that?
You can go ahead with the
question. Okay.
Yes, please go ahead with the question.
Yeah. Shubhangi, you were asked a question. Let me just scroll back.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Srevashi Dasgupta has written this question for you. Thank you for your paper, Shubhangini. I have a question. You spoke of Beloved. Do you find memory, as treated by Morrison in Beloved, plays an important role for recovery of healing of personal loss and Sid's obsessive relationship with her children? Sid could still bear the brutality of slavery, but broke down under the pressure of memory of slavery. Thus, it would be very nice if you may talk about memory as a narrative tool treated by Toni Morrison.
Okay. So, in anyone's life, there has always been a moment or an event that is so shocking and horrific that it is best to try to push it further and further back into your mind. So, when traumatized, it is very normal to close the memory, to suppress the terrible emotional experience. But sometimes this neglecting and abandoning might be the best way to forget. And so do the characters, Seth and also Paul D in the novel try to do. So trying to ignore their past and to avoid any related confrontations, they try to forget their terrible memories. But I think this forgetting is very temporary, as it lasts only until the smallest event prompts the memory, and then the formidable past is experienced once again, as painful as it once was. So, like, Seth tries to keep her memory at bay, but when a beloved returns back, she is once again with all the past, once again all the past dance in front of her, and she is tragically again derailed.
Right.
Who identifies herself with motherhood to a woman who begins to identify herself as being a human being. So Morrison has brought this picture to life by letting Seth face her past and bring to mind the events that she worked extremely hard to suppress and to forget. It seems impossible for her to remain in denial of the past. So right. I think memory, what the question was, that memory has played an important role for the recovery of history of Seth, recovery of the past, the healing of the personal loss of her daughter. the her obsession with her relationship. Like when Denver asks Seeth about her past, she always denied her. Not because she did not wanted to talk about them, but she herself was running away from them. But when Beloved asks her, repeatedly asks her the questions, and she excitedly Seeth explains them. Why? Because she was obsessed with her child, with her lost child, Beloved. So memory has a very important role in the novel, according to me.
Right. Thank you. Thank you very much. I think the scar on her back is like a representation, kind of a reminder of the memory that she had, I guess. Yes.
The tree which is ever present, but it can never be seen. It is a symbolic of the burden which Seeth carries, and that burden is her past, which was full of barbarity and tormentation. It is also the representation of what the school teacher wanted to determine, that how she resembled an animal. Even though she lived a life of animal in the slave plantation, but still he gave her a scar, which was a burden for her throughout her life. So she suffered from the very start till the end. So that, according to me, I think the relevance of the scar is very prominent in the novel. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We have for Sripurna, but I think Sripurna has already answered them back, and she had already left, so there is no point of asking again. Shriya is there? Shriya Das, ma'am, are you there?
Shriya Das, I think so. She is with us. Shriya, are you with us?
I think she has left. Anyways, she has already answered her question.
Okay.
So Sripurna has also answered her queries. Okay, so I think we are done with the question answer sessions. So if anything else to be done, Professor Dhaw, you can say that.
I think Sharmila Jajodia ma'am has switched on her microphone. If you would like to ask the question which you have asked earlier.
Acha. Right.
Ask that question. Yes.
Right. Let me just find out the question.
You have asked this question, is there any influence of Still I Rise by Maya Angelou
in my paper?
So I strongly agree with, because the title itself is indicative, however you try to oppress me or suppress me as a girl child, I will still rise and oppose. Hai na? Correct? So I strongly agree with that. Even I have written many poems with that effect. If you want, I can share one of my poems with you all.
Yes, ma'am. Please, ma'am, do that. Please.
So, I have written one poem when this Nirbhaya case happened in Delhi in 2012. Right. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Sure, ma'am.
So, I am going to share that poem with you all. It says, I have written, "Don't misbehave. I am a girl, not a toy. I am a human being full of life and charm, not a commodity to consume. Don't misuse your biological power to abuse me. You worship me as Lakshmi when you need money. You appease me as Saraswati when you need knowledge. You propitiate me as Kali or Durga when you need power and security. But you consider me an item to enjoy too. You forget that if I can give you birth, I am not powerless. If I can impart you knowledge, I am not ignorant. If I can bless you with money, I am not poor. But still you disrobe me and show your prowess, thinking that it enhances your status. You put conditions, I should not go out alone in dark, should not travel alone even in broad daylight, as I am weak, abla. I should not go to pubs as it doesn't suit me. I shouldn't wear revealing dresses, Western outfits to save myself from physical abuse. are they the real solutions, Mr. Misbehavior? Why don't you change yourself, your gaze, your thoughts, and the sick mind, which prompt you to do wrongs with infant girls and minor girls too? Irrespective of your relations, do their frocks provoke you? I understand the problem lies with your mindset, nothing else. As you like to bind me since ages in the chains of your mores, and even after so many years of independence, you are violating me, robbing me to make me feel like your slave. Don't treat me either as goddess or as nothing. Rather, consider me your equal. I am not pleading. It's my constitutional right. I am a human being only, not a devi or a plaything to satisfy your hunger. I say one thing only, one thing only. You can't rape me and roam free. You can't control my freedom. You can't terrorize me. I have nurtured you, and you repay me like this? Don't misbehave with me, inside or outside the house, even at lonely places with your gang. Otherwise, you never know when Vaishno Devi will reappear and kill the Bhairavaj. So this was my reply to sir, you, sir, regarding your query or observation.
Right.
So I think poem has substantiated what I have said in my paper as well.
Absolutely so. So I think with this, you know, this soulful rendition, soulful recitation of this poem, our program, our session comes to a perfect end. So with Professor Dhaw's permission, may I call it a day, Professor Dhaw? Can we
Yes, definitely we can call it a day. See, we did not get a lot of online traffic, but I think our presentation, I mean, this session was clean and uninterrupted. And thank you, all the
participants,
the presenters, for your active participation. With your permission, I would like to call it a day and end the session over here.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you all.
Yes. Thank you for your active participation.
मैंने मेरी पोयम भी सुना दी ना सबको.